So welcome to AI Insights with John Roese. For this episode, I want to comment on something we've been looking for about 70 years. You know, remember they said we'd have flying cars? Well, you know, we don't have them yet. But it's interesting, in this AI cycle, not only are we developing AI technology, but it's becoming an enabler that might actually allow us broadly to achieve some of the things that were in the Jetsons 50 years ago in the physical world, specifically for this discussion, flying cars. So Matt with Airspeeder with me, I'm going to let him describe Airspeeder to you, but it is a fascinating intersection between the physical world, the AI world, and kind of achieving this vision that we've had for decades about what the future might look like. And the one characteristic of the AI world right now is that future is happening much faster than it probably ever has in the past. So Matt, welcome, glad to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, tell us about Airspeeder.
Yeah, awesome. We're basically creating the F1 for flying cars at Airspeeder. So we saw the same thing you've seen, and we've all seen. We've all been waiting a really long time for this. Even Henry Ford was back in the day saying, mark my words, the car and the plane will eventually merge. I just don't know how to do it. And he didn't have the technology available to do it at the time. And so we've been promised, and it's always 20 years away. Now we seem to be on the cusp of it. We're, you know, there are air taxis that are going through certification and about to roll out kind of the Uber for flying cars in the near future. But when we looked at it, we thought, that's not how mobility revolutions have ever started. Henry Ford himself was a racing driver. Charles Rolls of Rolls-Royce was a racing driver. Marcel Renault of Renault was a racing driver. The first Daimler engines were used in racing cars. The first Mercedes were racing cars. So 120 years ago, the focus really was not on, hey, we're going to build taxis. It was, these are very expensive, very niche vehicles with no infrastructure to support them, no roads, no gas stations, no nothing. So the only thing we can do is go fast in circles. So when we looked at it, a lot of that applies for flying cars as well. As the first commercial application, it's probably going to be racing. And the benefit of that is we get this microcosm of a city of the future on one of our racetracks, where we get to play with augmented reality racetracks, and we have all the connectivity and the 6G links between the vehicles, and all the server infrastructure to run close collision avoidance in a way that no one in aviation is thinking about right now. You know, so we're still flying around in planes that were designed in the 60s. Aviation tends to move slowly for safety reasons. But we've kind of lost that space where in aviation where we would innovate in racing. And that was at the dawn of aviation, there were air races. The first working seaplane that the US Navy bought was in 1911. By 1913, there were racing seaplanes at Monaco. Within 18 years, they went from 40 miles an hour to 400 miles an hour and gave us planes like the Spitfire. That racing played a huge role in the early days of aviation. We want to do it again.
Yeah, no, Dell's got a big relationship with McLaren, and we've had a long history working with racing. And the most fascinating thing about racing isn't the racing part to me. I'm a technologist. It's that it is an area where you can aggressively adopt and ideate with technology to get to practical answers. And So maybe on that discussion, okay, you're trying to build flying racing cars.
Yes.
That you've actually built They're real now.
Yeah.
How much underlying both traditional technology, non-AI stuff, and how much AI technology is necessary for that to actually get to a reasonable outcome?
Absolutely. So we had to build a base layer for like data acquisition, you know, like first we had to build the physical vehicle. I thought that was going to be the hard part. Turns out connecting them was hard. All that infrastructure piece was much harder than the actual vehicle. And that was just to go, all right, now we're collecting petabytes of data per race. We've got more instrumentation than a Formula One car on one of these things. So there's a lot of data flowing out of it. And that's then given us, plus our simulation environments, our esports stuff, they're all generating huge amounts of data that we can use for training something that's not a fully autonomous system, because it's racing, you want a human in command, which is an interesting parallel with where AI is going. You want to be in command. A lot of times you want to be on the loop or in the loop. And then you want, but the pilot workload has to be managed, right? So all of that data is about allowing us to get closer together so we actually have more exciting racing. So we've built, like I said, we've built the vehicles, we've built the infrastructure to get the data off the vehicles in real time. And then we've started amassing our own little data lake as a startup, which is cool. But now the work begins with partners like Dell and Intel to go, let's get things as close as possible together in a smooth shared control kind of model.
Yeah, you know, your observation about, you know, what is the human role in this is critical. I mean, you couldn't imagine, you know, if the car just raced itself and there was no human involved, I'm not sure it would actually be racing. No. But on the other hand, you know, we were talking about the architecture of this car. If a human had to do everything, it wouldn't work.
No. Impossible.
It's impossible. Yeah.
So you cannot race it. You cannot fly a multi-copter without a robot involved in some way. It's just about where do you dial it up, right? Yep. For me, when I get my own one, when I get my two-seat sports version, I want all the training wheels on. I want all the safety features. I want to be able to fly with one hand on the wheel and have it take care of all the pilot workload. But in racing, you know, a racing pilot wants as much control as possible. My pilots are constantly talking to me about, like, can I flip it? Can I flip it today? Like, can we, you know, can you take all the safety features off and just let me go? So there's that ability to dial it up. But you're exactly right. You cannot fly at all without some sort of robotic system.
Yeah, you also, you know, kind of repeated something that we've seen continuously is that it's about the data. I mean, the mechanics of this are very important, but without the data, it doesn't work. And, you know, you were sharing with me that, you know, yes, there's data coming off the actual vehicles, but then I looked over at the side and there's all these simulators.
Yeah.
You know, how are you actually gathering these data sets and what's that look like?
Well, we love this. I mean, the goal is to do an AI force field. So kind of like two magnets repelling each other. You want it, as the closer you get, the more the force kind of repels you in the air. But you want that to feel, you don't want it to feel like someone grabbing the wheel from you and tugging at it. So it's about, we call it smooth shared control. And that requires a whole lot of pilot input data to go, well, what do people typically do? And then the next layer that I really want to work with you on is how do we go to the personalized version of that? So your AI co-pilot has been trained through you, with you in the simulator, and is personalized to your style of flying. And then you take that same model and run it on the real vehicle. So that's the type of thing that, When I started talking about this, people said, you're crazy. There's no way to get things that close together. Now the technology, I think, is ubiquitous.
Well, you know, something we predicted that hasn't happened fully yet, but is inevitable, and that is this idea of, you know, agents with lifespans. Yeah. Their lifespan is not a moment in time on a particular piece of technology. Like, imagine your world, you know, once I understand and have agents that understand my biofeedback in a transportation setting and my preferences and my behaviors, the idea is that those things should be able to move around. And that if I happen to be the pilot of one of your vehicles, there's a whole bunch of AI knowledge and understanding that is transferable to kind of shape not just the cosmetics, I want the window open or down, or I want the seat adjusted, but actually how I prefer to interact with the transportation vehicle, what my expectations are, what my safety profile is. Yeah. All of that stuff should really drop below the machine layer. And as agents become more personalized to us, they're an interface into all kinds of, you know, utilities that we can touch.
Well, then they become an extension of yourself, right? So you want to make it invisible. So, hey, I know this is tailored to me because it just feels intuitive. It feels supernatural to me because it is. Constantly dialing up, like, who is more in control of the wheel right now, depending on what I'm doing or how close to the edge I am or how close I am to another vehicle. So it's a beautiful analog for how we should be interacting with these agents. But the ability now to go, cool, I've got hundreds of thousands of people playing a game and I'm using that input data. I'm using all of our 90% reality simulator data as well, and then all of our test flight data, all of our race data as well. And then you run these pre-trained multi-agent reinforcement learning models. That gets really exciting really fast.
Well, one thing, you know, that people may not realize if you take on a domain like you're taking on is that you can't have a power cord hanging off of this.
No.
It is a self-contained entity that you are competing for energy between propulsion and compute.
Yeah.
And so we talked a little bit about this. That is a very real problem people have to navigate, that you can do an infinite amount of AI and then have no energy left to actually move the vehicle, or you can kind of balance it. So this idea of, you know, efficient AI is critical.
Totally. It's like rockets, right? Like, every bit of weight that you add, like every time you make the battery slightly bigger, you need more batteries and that. Yep. So it just runs away. So every ounce that you can shave out of the battery pack, or which is, you know, obviously the biggest heaviest component apart from the pilot, every ounce you shave from that has just exponential gains. So my engineers are constantly reminding me, well, how many more sensors do you want to put on this thing? So it's this balance of data acquisition and weight, the constant battle. We're saving weight in other ways, like using generative design. I mean, it's been around for forever, but it's still giving us like spectacular gains when we're able to suck metal out of the thing. And we were talking yesterday about all the carbon printing that we're doing now. So that's good, but yeah, just having low power, thinking about this as a flying AI PC is a really good way of going, this is low power, personalized to you, and able to, but extremely powerful in what it can actually do.
Yeah, and able to talk to the rest of the AI ecosystem. I sometimes describe agents are going to phone friends.
Yeah.
If they can't answer it, they'll go external.
Yeah.
So maybe last, you know, the ever-present question, I already know the answer, but people won't know the answer. When can people see these? When are they real?
So they're real now. We are flying around in the Australian desert at the moment. So we're doing a couple of races a year. We're still proving out the technology. And now at this point, we've got 3 speeders in the air simultaneously, and doing live broadcast races, which has taken a lot. It's taken a village to get to this point. We want to bring them here. Like that's going to be a next step with our partners. We're very excited about the U.S. Very similar regulatory environment. Yeah. It's interesting seeing how Google Wing and Amazon Prime and stuff, these guys test their technology in Australia and then bring it to the US. So you've been able to order a pizza by drone for years in Australia. Now, you know, then it gets deployed in the US. Same thing with us. We're in the proving ground out in the desert in Oz. But watch this space. In the next little while, we hope to be over here tearing it up.
Well, I think we'll probably have some people at your next race, and maybe we'll put some video up here about showing this stuff live. You know, again, they said we would have flying cars. We are getting very close, or actually have some flying cars, and turns out can't do flying cars without AI. And so that's probably a good intersection.
Absolutely right.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Yeah.